Yo, what it do? It's your boy DJ Fly. Got chicken in the pilot to the game, man. I'm on my hip hop ish. The DJ's running game. If you didn't know, you know now. I really got it in high school. I was going through like a bunch of names. I've been DJing for a while, but I didn't have an official DJ name. So I was in school and I was always on chilling. And it was like I had an old soul. So my teacher told me one day I was like a young fly guy, and it just stuck. So I just went from there. It actually hit me when I was 11 or 12. I was out, my family owns a skate rink on the south side of Atlanta called Skate Town. So I grew up there passing out skates, and I got tired of passing out skates because it's not the move. So after every time we were closed, I just went to hop on the turntables and taught myself how to DJ, and then just went from there.
Taught yourself how to DJ. Like, okay, so you said you taught yourself how to DJ, but obviously when you're teaching yourself, you had to mimic someone else, or you had to look up to someone else that was DJing. Like,
right.
Like who was that?
My mentor and who I'm with now, DJ Hershey. Him and my dad grew up together. They were best friends in high school, so they kind of just coincided with each other.
Okay, so DJ Hershey, you listened to his tapes, you heard him on the radio. I understand you say him and your father grew up together.
Yeah.
So what about Hershey that you said, you know what, I like what he's doing, I want to kind of do that, and I want to jump into the game. Like, give me like kind of like that back story, right?
It was like, I'm from the hood. I'm a young. I hop in the car and just ride. So moms would always hop in the car around 4 or 5 o'clock for the 5 o'clock traffic jam mix. And I would always hear him DJing. And before I listened to anybody else's mix, I would always listen to his. So it was like a coincidence. Every time I hopped in the car as a kid, till this day, I would always catch him on the radio before I caught anybody else. And I just liked his style and liked the way he did what he did. And till this day, he still does it.
Okay. So I looked you up, and you're not just a club DJ, man. You're a tour DJ. You're all around the world, man. For those who might not know, give us what you're doing, what you're involved with. Like, let us know.
I can let y'all know what I got going on so far. So what's going on? Basically, it's like I DJ for Roscoe Dash. I've DJed for Young Thug on occasions. OG Maco was a good homie of mine from high school. Done a couple things for him. You guessed the record actually came not from me, but I was one of the first DJs to break it and put it on the internet. So it's like you can still look that up to this day. And it's kind of like a big deal because even with, of course, clubs was like the first thing I did. It went from clubs to tour to just DJing on my own DJ tour. So I go to Japan and DJ by myself on a tour. So that's just what it became by itself. I didn't really, I wouldn't say I did it. It's just what I did to get there.
You was right.
How'd you link with Roscoe Dash? Like, how did that come about? You DJing for him and going to Japan? Like, give me that story.
I actually met him at a team party. I can't say where because I really don't remember. It was so long ago. I was like 16. I was at a team party. This was right before he got signed. Ran into him and told him I worked with him one day. And I spoke into existence. I ended up linking up with MMI. And then I was cool. I love my plug. I was actually part of I love my plug. And then Cutthroat was a DJ at the time. And then it was like, I guess I kind of suited the situation better. So they picked me as a world DJ and then we went from there.
What about Japan?
Man, it's a great place. Everything I really got on, like jewelry wise, is from them. So it's pretty cool. So like this little chain. It just came from them, but it's real homie. So it's like you go out there and it's a whole nother world. I went there the first day. I didn't expect anything that I got had going on the first. As soon as I got off the flight, I went straight to DJing. I probably took a shower and ate right before I DJed, and I went straight to the club. After that, they woke me up the next morning, probably 10 o'clock in the morning. I just left the club at 5 in the morning. And it's like, we got another gig to do. We got an in-store situation to do, so I did the in-store. And I went to sleep for like a couple hours, and I woke back up. And it's like constant moving. Like everybody over there works. There's no sleep for real. So that's how I developed this whole mentality of just work.
Work. So in Japan, I mean, give us some of the differences and similarities. Like I've never been there. So take us. You get there. You take a shower. You go straight to the club.
Yeah.
What's the club scene like?
The club scene is basically, you'll be surprised, they don't listen to half the stuff we would think they listen to, like the whole tech. There's probably like a couple of techno clubs and actually Japanese music, but they love Atlanta hip hop. So everything that comes out in Atlanta today, they know it by tomorrow. Like they sit there and study music. So when I'm playing songs, they're in there singing word for word. Just yeah, it was pretty cool. I was surprised myself. Yeah, as long as it's like the block, like they listen to certain blocks. So if it's like a block that's covered in Atlanta, they pretty much own it. So it's like they log on every day like we probably do here as a DJ, and they listen just as fast. And they'll go find the music, they'll go buy the music just because they like it. They won't go just get it for free. They actually support music. So that's Japan's big on that.
What you eat over there, man? I heard the food, don't touch it, man.
So the first day, I was being experimental. I did this, I thought it was meatballs. Around my whole life. I ate it, and it was a squid head. But it, so, after that, I went to KFC every day from there. Every day.
Terrible.
As an artist, this guy just caught on to the name Joe Green. He got a track called Trap Funkin'. I guarantee it's gonna be out here in the next couple months. I called records, I haven't been wrong yet, so I think it's gonna be it. Recently was, like I said, OG Maco. Did you guess the record? It was easy. All it took was a couple months. We put it out. OG Maco hit my phone probably in May. I got the song. I finally got the one. He been rapping for a while. So he was like, he sent it. And I listened to it. I was like, nah, I don't like it. Second day, I played it again. Maybe. And I played it in the club. I forgot what club I was at, but I just played it just to hear it. And it was it. So we put it out in June. 2-3 months later, I get a call saying he signed with Quality Control. And it just went from there.
Bitch, you guessed it. So you say you played a hand.
You was right.
Breaking that record?
I can say that. Okay. The stats are there. You can go look. I can honestly say that one.
That's real right there. That's real right there. Any plaques yet? Roscoe Dash gave you any one of his plaques?
Plaques? I don't really see a big thing on those because I don't really care for them.
Okay.
Because it's like I broke another record that still can be played in the club. Like Racks back in the day, didn't get a plaque for that.
Tell me about Racks.
I was at...
Before you tell me that story, there's a two-part to that story.
Yeah.
So Racks is featuring Future and what's the guy?
YC.
YC and Future.
Mm-hmm.
You can easily forget the guy's name. No disrespect. But we see Future, but I don't really see much of YC. Tell me that story. Whose record was it? Was it both of their records?
From what I was told before it was put out, it was Future's record, but they gave it to YC, and it was YC. That's why YC got the verse first, but it was originally Future's song because he's also on the hook. Right. So it just went from there. But it's, of course, that situation. I don't get into that. I'm just a DJ.
No doubt.
But then after we got it, it was just an instant hit to me, so I just ran with it. I had frequency probably 4 or 5 nights a week, 16, 17 years old. I'm going to school as soon as I leave the club. But it's like I'm playing a record, and Future would come through weekly, like every week, just buying bottles and popping bottles and just getting a section. After that, it took off. I probably give it 2 weeks after that. It just took off after that. It was quick. The internet is one hell of a thing now, man.
It is.
Because music is unpredictable now. You got to look at like blogs come, like drop a song from an artist every day. You never know which one. That's why I have to go through and I have to study every day. It's like going to school. I wake up every day and hop on my computer and see what's out, what's new, what people are listening to. I even go on Twitter and search what people listen to just to see what's going on and stay on my game. So that's all it is.
That's real. You one of the first DJs that actually said they actually study and go through music to see what's actually hot. Right?
Yeah.
Other DJs have different versions of how they find music or whatever, but you stay up on top. So you're saying social media is big with you staying on top of what the music is?
Very much. Like, you can look at Vine. That's really what people base OG Maco off of, but it was before Vine. But it's like Vine, Instagram, Twitter, all that stuff plays a big part. Because the songs that, like, you can just see a girl twerking. A dude might like the song because he kept seeing the girl twerk to that video. So it's like, I got to go find that song. And that's how people are found. That's how hits are being made these days. It's a new game. It's a new age. It just changes every day. You never know. I'm a Serato man. I started off a virtual DJ, but I'm a Serato man. I can't use anything else. I've used Tractor. I've used... Serato. Serato itch, Serato scratch, DJ intro, all of that. But Serato, the main Serato is, that's all I can use because I'm home. That's where I'm comfortable at. I love it. Right now, I got a couple mixtapes that I got in a vault that I haven't touched at all. I got names, mixtape covers. I promoted the mixtape covers here and there, but I just never put it out because it's like all mixtapes out now by mixtape DJs are all the same songs. I don't want to do that. I can't do it.
Disgusting, bro.
I remember when I was 16, used to go around the studios after school and get music from a certain artist. So it's like I'm still doing that to this day. I'm just trying to wait for the perfect moment to put out that song. So it's like the couple mixtapes I do put out, I always have at least 2 or 3 exclusives that no one's ever heard before on there. And of course, songs that I feel like independent artists that are building, and I can push them also. But other than that, I don't really touch mixtapes because it's too ugly right now. Basically, it's either monologue or social media, because I don't step out too much in Atlanta. Unless when I'm out of town, I run into a lot of artists. But in town, I'm really chill. I go to the club and work and go home. I don't really do too much. You know, you don't hang around at work when you off. That's like going to work for free. I can't do it. So I might go out every now and then to see what's hot and what's popping. But other than that, artists really approach me on here's my CD. And I don't ever tell them who I am because I'm real in the cut wise. So it's like, you might just give me a CD and never know who I am. I'm just chilling. And I might go home and listen to it. Then I might hit you up because that's why it's important to leave your contact information on the CDs that you give me. You got to, because if you don't, I'm going to get in contact with you. But that's just how I rock. But we were at Mansion one time with Thug. I might get in trouble saying this later, but I don't even care. It was basically one of the situations. We in the VIP chilling, and I guess some dude said something to him or looked at him weird, and he just punched him in the face, and like the whole squad, we just walked out. Like nothing happened. We just walked out the section.
Young Thug punched somebody in the face.
And we just left. I mean, he wasn't going to fight back. There's 20 niggas with him, right. And he in the section by himself. So what you going to do? So yeah, it got ugly quick, and I was just like, I guess it's time to go. So are y'all pulling that, saying what y'all saying about him? Don't say it to him. I don't know what might happen.
Gotcha.
Next 5 years, I'm coming for Diddy. Diddy, Jay-Z, all of them. As a DJ perspective, though. So it's like, I'm putting a twist on the game to where artists are cool, but it's like, it's so many artists that, I won't say they don't matter, but it's so much going on that it's nothing else going on. So it was nothing to build on. It's just like a new song come out. That song's hot for a week. That's it. As far as a DJ being on an artist level, I'm going to try that. Because I salute Drama, I salute Khaled, I salute a couple other DJs that do it. But it's like they're doing it on, I see a big open lane that they left open. So I'm going to take it.
Gotcha.
So in 5 years, I might run a label, be an A&R, run a couple artists, stuff like that. You never know. Because without us, the music wouldn't be out. I mean, you got your Twitter, your Instagram, all that stuff, but if it's not being played in the club by a DJ or being spent on the radio by a DJ or being pushed by a DJ, it doesn't matter. Because that record only have so long. It'll crawl. It won't walk. It'll never walk without a DJ. So DJs run the game for that reason. Well, basically, it's like anybody that's aspiring to be a DJ, be in the music industry, period, I don't believe in competition with me because I'm on a different caliber of what I'm doing. So it's like, if you want to work with me, it's cool. We can work. Hit me up on Twitter, at DJ_fly_guy. Instagram's the same thing. Facebook, / IamDJFlyGuy. And just reach out to me, man, because I support any young person trying to do something positive with themselves. Stay out of trouble and stay on whatever you want to do. Don't do something that somebody else want to do because it won't be what you wanted to do, and you end up being depressed about it. So for right now in Atlanta, I'm about to go back on the road soon, but every Tuesday you can catch me at Sledge Lounge off on Buford. It's the same spot that Hot 107.9 does on Sundays, but with Sledge Lounge, me and my boy DJ Ace from 94.5, we there each and every Tuesday from 10 till about 3, 4 in the morning. Come through, get your record played. We rock with artists. You know, it's simple. Just hit me up.
You rockin' with the hottest shit. You can't get anywhere else. On my hip hop.
What brought me to DJing? First, I've always respected the power of a DJ. On a good night, the DJ can take you from going home with somebody to going home.